thank you very much for coming tonight. Fascinating topic, and once again, I'm thrilled to be teaching with Rabbi Trump. Last week's was really exciting. If you missed it live, you can always catch it online. And we're going to go to a totally different part of the world and the historical landscape today. We're going to move from Christian Europe to the Muslim lands. And of course, for most of diaspora history, Jews experienced either living as a minority within Christian lands or living as a minority with Muslim lands. Very, very different experiences right up into the 20th century. Spain is always that somewhat complex situation because it's a triangular culture. But today we're going to go right to the heart of Muslim civilization, and we're going to look at the life of Saadia Gaon. Just a quick word on the periodization. You'll recall from the first class, Jews tend to create historiographic groupings of time based on generations of scholars, not based on external historical events. In fact, using terms like medieval with regards to Jews is very difficult because, you know, for example, while Christian Europe was sunk in the Dark Ages, you know, we had Rashi. You know, maybe a little bit later we had Rashi, but we still had, like, this is actually part of the Dark Ages. So the terminology that we use in the outside world doesn't necessarily fit the Jewish historiography. The period that we're talking about today is the classical Gaonic period, from the word Gaon. The word Gaon is derived from the Hebrew word Ga'ava, which means pride in the positive sense. When you say someone is a Gaon, it's someone who is worthy of pride, right? As opposed to Gaiva in the Musar sense, which means a negative kind of arrogance. If someone was a Gaon, like the Vilna Gaon, of which every single Lithuanian Jew I've ever met has actually, you know, directly related to him. Saadia Gaon, the term Gaon is a title, like I say, a marker of great learning. It also happens to be an institutional title in this period because this is the period when the Talmud had closed and the center of Jewish learning was still in Babylon for the most part, what would be today southern Iraq and Kuwait, and it was headed up by the yeshivas there, the Babylonian yeshivas, continuing the tradition of the Talmud. So Saadia Gaon was one of those great leaders of one of the major yeshivas in the immediate post-Talmudic time. So if you recall the very first class when we talked about periodization, we have the period of the Tanaim, which is the Mishnah, the period of the Amoraim, which is the Talmud, the Gemara. Then we get to the period of the Gaonim, which is one step back from when we were last week, which was the Rishonim. Okay, enough. One last word about his name, Saadia. It's interesting, it sounds almost Arabic. It's actually a Hebrew word, or maybe it's Aramaic. Sa'ad in Aramaic means to help, to assist. So, Lisayeya, I guess it's a Hebrew word too. So, Saadia means, you know, helped by God, the Gaon, the Great One. Okay, so let's go straight to the material today. His years are 1882 to 942, the end of the 9th and the beginning of the 10th century. His main area of activity was in Egypt and then later in Babylon. He is known as one of Judaism's first philosophers. So in order to put him in context, I have to give you a little bit of sense of what is the relationship of Judaism and philosophy, and where does he fit within this developing canon of texts? We, as Jews, have a sort of love-hate relationship with philosophy. The word philosophy is, of course, Greek in origin, as we understand philosophy as a whole to be Greek in origin. I think it was Whitehead who said that all philosophy are footnotes to Plato. Like, we had this one great Greek philosopher, Plato, who is shown here in the red, by the way, and everything that he wrote, which was essentially the teachings of his teacher, Socrates, shown here, the rather buff guy up here, that formed the Western tradition of philosophy. The word comes from philo, which means I love or to love, and sophia, which means wisdom, the love of wisdom, just the pure love of knowledge for its own sake. The Greek tradition, which developed under this man Socrates here in Periclean Athens 500 years before the Common Era, was characterized by an unremitting questioning of reality, an unremitting questioning of every fact, of every preconception. The Socratic method was so named after Socrates because he questioned absolutely everything. He claimed to be the wisest man in all of Athens because he knew that he knew so little. Like, for example, he meets a soldier and he says to the soldier, "Oh, you're a professional warrior. You must know something about courage." He says, "In fact, I do know something about courage." So he says to him, Charmides was his name, "Well, tell me, is courage like running blindly into battle?" And he says, No. You have to like be cautious. That's not courageous to run blindly into battle." He says, "Oh, really? So it means to hold back from fighting." He says, No. Sometimes you have to go and fight. So Socrates, by asking one question after another, would eventually break down the concept of courage until finally he got to a kernel of what he said, this must be the essence of what courage is. And that method of teaching, of asking the students the questions and uncovering the, so to speak, to use a modern sense, I think it was Henry Moore, the sculptor? Richard Moore? What was his first name? Moore?
Sculptor.
Henry Moore? Right. He used to say that the sculpture was already contained within the block of marble, and his job was just to remove the excess. So that's the Socratic method of teaching. This particular picture, of course, is a very famous Jacques-Louis David, the end of the 18th century. It depicts the famous suicide of Socrates because he was kind of a rabble-rouser and all the youth were attracted to him and he was kind of breaking down Athenian values. He was forced by the elders to either recant and refuse to teach the youth anymore or drink hemlock, a deadly poison, and he chose the latter. And here he is consoling his obviously distraught students, including Plato, who's at his knee here, and he's saying to him in a famous passage in the Apology of Socrates, "Death is either a just reward," pointing heavenward, "or a dreamless sleep." And he drank the hemlock and he died. So as Jews, we loved philosophy. We just got so into it. It got us into trouble. That's why we had the Hanukkah rebellion, because we just loved it so much that it tended to overwhelm traditional Gemara ways of thinking and certain logical systems that did not comport with the same kind of logic that the Greeks used. But we, although we had to like kind of find a balancing point with philosophy, nevertheless, we loved the pure rational aspect of it. We loved engaging in pure debate, and the sense of it, the love of wisdom, the love of truth for its own sake, really appealed to us. But we did not develop many distinctively Jewish philosophies in the ancient era. Perhaps the greatest one is this man here, Philon, also known as Philo. They named a very delicious pastry after him. You may have seen that. And he was an Egyptian scholar, Jewish scholar, who essentially wrote a philosophy of the Bible. Because in many ways he differed from the rabbinic tradition, he has not been absorbed into the traditional canon. So you will not read Philo if you go to yeshiva. He's just like sort of out there. But he had a massive influence on Christian philosophy, who borrowed from him and his translations of biblical and rabbinic texts into Greek, so a major part of it. But still, he's kind of chutz lamachaneh, outside of the camp, in terms of the march of Jewish intellectual ideas. The first real philosopher, in the sense of the word that we're using right now, the first one to make an impact within the Jewish tradition, mainstreaming Jewish tradition, would be Saadia Gaon, who was not influenced directly by Greek philosophy, but by Arabic philosophy, which was in itself an inheritor of Greek philosophy. And he gave us a different way of thinking about text, thinking about tradition, that was heavily influenced by Muslim models. And perhaps the greatest innovation, in my humble opinion, I'm not an expert in this field, but his greatest innovation was in terms of his expression of those ideas. Numbered paragraphs is a kind of a Saadia-esque, is that a word, Professor Levy? Saadia-esque? Saadia-itic? Saadia... It's like a Saadia would do that.
Sadducean?
No, it's something else. He would just say, okay, like the Greeks didn't do this, But the Kalam philosophers of the Mutazilite trend, which is a Muslim way of approaching the Quran, they were using these numbered paragraphs. They said, okay, this is chapter number one, idea number one, idea number two, sub-idea 2A. And it was just so organized. It was mathematical. It was logical. It was lockstep. You were like, get onto the rails, and you could not get off his track because it was so straightforward. It was like, you know, what do they say? Quid est demonstrandum, something like that. It's totally demonstrated, you know, quod est demonstrandum. It is completely demonstrated. You can't walk away from it. That's the kind of impact he had. Off the top of your head, you may not have read too much Saadia, Gaon, but who really adopted this more than anyone else, who really shaped? Rabbi? Rambam. You're cheating, you already have smicha, but you're right. The Rambam, he disagreed with Saadia Gaon in so many ways, but he loved the format. Oh my gosh, what a great way to present ideas. I often use it in my emails nowadays. Let's put it inside the global context now. So what is Islam, just for a quick moment, to give you a sense of how this fits with Jewish history? So Islam as a faith emerges in the 7th century from Central Arabia here, and it spreads with amazing rapidity throughout the entire Mediterranean basin, taking over the entire Arabian Peninsula in a very short period of time. You can see here the colors here. This is the solid green is when Muhammad died. I believe it was in 632, I think. So this is the region that became Islamicized. Lots of Jews and Christians living in this region at that time. Muhammad borrows very liberally from Christian and Jewish ideas. They are integrated into Islam. Then it spreads after his death throughout the Persian Empire. This is the part that is especially relevant for us here in the Mesopotamian region between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. And then, of course, across the coast of North Africa. And then in the year 711, easy to remember, they make it up into Spain. And every year on 711, they give away free Slurpees all throughout Spain. I don't know why. I'm in a good mood. And they even came close to conquering Europe proper. They were eventually held back, but they came quite close to the European continent per se. So the reasons for the spread of Islam are beyond our scope today, but I will point out one very important thing. Islam definitely did have some coercive measures, and if you read historiography of the 19th century, especially white Christian European historiographers, they would emphasize the, you know, convert or die kind of picture of this Muslim spread. But in reality, Islam was an incredibly powerful body of ideas. It was remarkably colorblind vis-a-vis other faiths. I mean, you look at the massive spread of Islam in regions where people have darker skin, for example, very, very strong appeal in what would be today Pakistan, Bangladesh, northern India. It had a redemptive ideology that put it in line with the monotheistic faiths in a way that, you know, Islam was a very competitive group of ideas. There was also some social elements that conversion to Islam gave a person a really quick leg up in terms of social standing. And in fact, you have many examples of that beyond the scope today. Jews actually did pretty well in Muslim empires. They were especially well situated in the southern region of those two major rivers, where they had already developed the Talmudic academies of Surah, Pambadita, Naharda, all of these place names that are very familiar to anyone who even moves through half a page of Talmud. You will come across these great yeshivas. And these were, especially through the 5th century, the major locus of learning for the Jewish world, eclipsing Israel, of course, after the disasters of the First Roman Jewish War and then the Bar Kokhba rebellion that unfortunately failed. So once Jewish life in Israel became extremely tenuous, then the Babylonian academies became even more prominent, and they retained that prominence well up into the second millennium. That's the Gaonic period that we are speaking of today. The Jews actually did fairly well in Muslim countries in many ways. We should bear in mind that Islam and Judaism, I wanted to get a nice, this is kind of a cheesy picture, but the point is still there.
The guy on the left is Jewish.
The guy on the left is Jewish.
The picture's been debunked. It's a posed picture.
It's a posed picture. That's not hard to believe. The guy on the left is Jewish and this guy is Muslim? What is... No. Okay. But the idea is we have to, like, there's no question that right now, as we're speaking in the year 2017, there has been a sustained conflict in Israel between Jews and Arabs that has resulted in many wars and a tremendous amount of bloodshed and ongoing political conflict. But if we can go back prior to the 19th century, we see that for the most part, Jews actually did, pound for pound, better in Muslim lands than they did in Christian lands. There were certainly moments of violence and persecution, but the scope and the depth of that persecution is nowhere similar in Muslim lands as you would have by comparison in Christian lands. Again, a discussion for a later class than this, but by and large, we did better in Muslim lands than in Christian lands. I skipped over a slide. It didn't get squeezed in there somehow. Technical difficulties. Well, there's another picture over here that's the same kind of idea. Why is this so that we got along with the Muslims so well? We can point to several factors. One is, first of all, that as a culture, Judaism tends to have much more similarity with Islam than it does with Christianity. Islam, like Judaism, is an orthopractic faith in which there's all kinds of behaviors that are markers of Islamic orthodoxy, whereas Christianity has a lot more attached to creed, meaning what one believes. So in Islam, as long as you're behaving according to certain parameters, there's actually a lot more intellectual freedom. I know it's strange to say that in the 21st century when Islam has not gone through a reformation like Christianity did, and to a certain degree even Judaism did. So we have like kind of the vocabulary of intellectual discourse. Islam does not necessarily have that in the 21st century by comparison. But, you know, Islam, for example, they'll pray five times a day, we pray three times a day. We have kashrut, they have halal. We have Chinese food, they have falafels. They have, you know, there's like a lot of things that are sort of balancing out. There's an emphasis on levels of modesty for women. There are all kinds of things that culturally, there's kind of like they're resonating with each other to a much greater degree than Christians would. And Christians placed a lot more emphasis on what a person believes, whether or not a person went through that singular salvific act of baptism, for example, is a major deal when it's only a one-time, even an infancy ritual that may not have any other impact on a person's thinking later. Those are things that are important to Christianity. They're not so important to Islam. So we had cultural similarities. Jews in Arab lands also, as we discussed last week, tended to adopt a survival strategy of acculturation much more than we did in Christian lands. In Christian lands, especially after the Crusades, there was an emphasis on insularity, of looking inward, of trying to be different, of trying to maintain our isolation, not necessarily so in Muslim lands. Okay, let's go down to talk about Saadia himself. So he's born, as I mentioned, possibly 1892, but definitely in the late 9th century. He came from a very simple family. His father was not a learned Jew, and in fact, this was brought as a grave criticism against Saadia by his opponents when he was promoted to be the head of the academy. But he was a child prodigy of incredible proportions. He wrote his first book at 11 and actually republished it several times afterwards because it was a classic. He was a philologist. He was a poet. He had tremendous facility with the Hebrew language. And by the age of 23, he already had an extensive school of students who were drawn to him as a master teacher. He was also a very hot-tempered individual. We'll see a couple of quick examples of this in his life, and I know Rabbi Trump is going to speak about this as well in text, but he had an ongoing, really bitter fight with the Karaites. Karaism is a movement that emerged about this time in the same region that rejected the oral tradition. The Karaites accepted the written Torah, the first five books of Moses. They considered that binding, but all of the other material, the Mishnah and the Talmud in particular, are rejected. Saadia took them on extensively, and we have a lot of back and forth, nasty literature published as a result. And ironically, we know a lot about Saadia from the surviving Karaite literature. So, like, they will come up with all kinds of arguments against Saadia, and by reading those arguments, we know a lot about what Saadia himself thought, as I put in this point here, right? Like, example, the seven proofs for the necessity of the oral Torah, he didn't bother recording that in any of his other works, but in his polemical literature, when he wants to demonstrate to the Karaites, here are seven reasons why you guys are totally, totally wrong, so we have from the Karaite literature, we can draw back to what Saadia says. He had a huge kind of turning point debate when he was already left. He'd left Egypt and he had gone to the Babylonian region, and there was a huge debate over the calculation of the new moon. As I'm sure everyone in this room is familiar, but maybe I'll say it for the benefit of the internet audience, we actually have quite a few people in Latvia and Thailand, for example, who actually watch these videos. The Jewish calendar is really complicated because it is lunisolar. It is basically lunar, like the Arabic calendar, but because the lunar year is only 354 days long, that means that it loses 11 days every year. Hence the holiday of Ramadan, for example, the month-long holiday, is in a different season. Every decade or so, it's moved back, you know, to a different season. But the Jewish calendar has a requirement that Passover be celebrated in April, because that's when you can charge the most for matzah. No, that's not why, Rabbi. So, no, Passover is called HaChodesh HaAviv, right? Or the Chag HaAviv, the holiday of springtime. So therefore, Passover must fall in the springtime. So therefore, the Jewish tradition is to add a leap month every so often. We now have a fixed calendar, but back then there was some debate over the fixed calendar, and Saadia disagreed with the calculations of that month with the major scholar Aaron ben Meir of Yerushalayim. They engaged in a very extensive public debate over this, and Saadia ended up winning. As a result of his dialectical brilliance and his sheer pugnaciousness, he was appointed to become the Gaon of Sura, the head of one of the two major academies. This is essentially the Harvard of Babylon, or as many people call it, the Turo College of Babylon, one of the greatest yeshivas in the region, and he was appointed. In his letters of approbation, David ben Zakkai, very important figure we shall see, said that he is not afraid of any man and does not show, what does he say here? Let's see what I quoted here. Favor to anyone, right? He praised him because he was so bold and he would take on anyone. Unfortunately, he would ultimately take on the person who hired him, which is not a good idea for the new rabbi in town, right? The new rabbi in town should not take on the president of the board. Basically, what happened is this. In Babylon, you have this position called the exilarch. Right, the exilarch term is in Hebrew, in Aramaic, resh galuta, the head of the exile. This was a government position, as it were, a state-supported position, which was given to a member of the house of David, right, from the lineage of David, and the Babylonians recognized that person as the head of the Jewish community. Exilarch, the word archos in Greek means leader, and exile, of course, like diaspora, exile. So he was the leader of the exile, and he had the right to appoint the chief rabbis of the, I have to be careful, the president of the synagogue is in the room, so, and the rabbi, assistant rabbi is in the room too, so I have to be doubly careful. We'll just rewind that and we won't put it on the internet. But the exilarch hired Saadia Gaon to be the head of the academy, and they wrote a contract, and included in the contract was a non-disobedience clause, which Saadia agreed to. And then what happened is Saadia was asked to rule on a monetary case that involved the exilarch, his boss, and Saadia ruled against him. Saadia refused to support his erstwhile boss, which ended his tenure at the yeshiva of Sura. And he was fired. And that was a huge blow for him. And he was forced to endure, I think it was 20 years without a position. And during that period of unemployment, he was incredibly creative. And he produced some phenomenal works which have lived for a millennium as a result. So there's like a hidden bracha in this sudden unemployment. What kind of things did he contribute? We're going to see some of the texts from Rabbi Trump, but just to break it down to the six basic areas, lexicography, he did a huge amount with Hebrew grammar. He let us understand what's going on with the Hebrew language, which again is an extremely important thing. Language was not codified nearly to the degree we have in the 20th century. Great titles like Explanation of 90 Difficult Words, also known as icebreakers for Babylonian parties. A rhyming dictionary, The Song of the Letters, that was like a poem about what each of the letters meant, what they had to say, building on a tremendous Gemara and Shabbos Kuf Dalet. He wrote the first Siddur, the very first actual liturgy in a printed form, a manuscript form that we have. Biblical commentary, of course, the Rabbi Saadia Gaon on the Talmud is fascinating. The polemical literature against the Karaites, we already mentioned. A lot of halakha, and finally, philosophical works, which is perhaps his most best known. Did I include it in the, yes I did. We'll just go through this here. One of his most important books is this codification of Jewish thought, the Book of Beliefs and Opinions, in which he writes in this Kalam Mutazilite style of the numbered paragraphs, this is what we believe, this is emistic, what we actually believe as Jews. Of course, the Rambam will disagree with a lot of those points and we'll have lots more literature to continue with. So that's my very quick overview of the life of Saadia Gaon, and now we're going to have an introduction to his thought from our esteemed Rabbi Trump.
And it is a distinct pleasure to follow that. Let's try to get the other side of the equation. We are essentially these evenings trying to meet people we don't know, we haven't met, we're not going to meet within this world, but hopefully after a little bit of time that we spend together, we'll get to really know who they are. Because although they've been gone for a very long time, we get a sense of who they really are through where they came from, through their background, and through what they actually say. Hopefully you get a sense of the voice. What I like to do is I like to piggyback on some of the ideas that Dr. Abramson talked about, and let's see examples of what he actually did. Let's see examples of how he expressed himself and the words he uses. So we're going to go through five different domains. We have the texts in front of you in the packets, but they're also going to be on the screen as well. We're not going to read all of them. Inside we're going to read some of them. We're going to deal with five different aspects. His parashanut, how he is his pirush on the Torah, his idea, his polemics, as Dr. Abramson mentioned, as it relates to the Karaites, his halacha, as a halachic leader of the generation, his siddur, and we're going to talk about his philosophy as well, just as examples of what Rav Saadia Gaon did. Now, it happens to be, some people add in the Rav Saadia Gaon. It's not really necessary, as Dr. Abramson admitted it, because Gaon itself is the term for the greatest rabbinic post of the time, right? So it isn't really necessary, but you'll notice on some books today, I'll have Rav Saadia Gaon as well. It's sort of like adding, Hillel and Shammai, sort of adding Rav Hillel. So it detracts sometimes to say that. But nonetheless, let's jump straight in. So the first thing is I'd like to start with is actually in his Parshanut. But I came across, I was going through a lot of the work, and I came through a fascinating story, which I really think says something about him. This is a story which is actually related by Rav Chaim David Azulai. Right? So Rav Azulai says a very interesting thing, the Chida. He says a very fascinating story about Rav Saadia Gaon. So here it goes. Ready? So he says he recounts the following. He says that Rav Saadia Gaon one day was having an interaction with a tailor, and he said to the tailor, "How many stitches did you stitch today?" And the tailor's response was, if you go into the text itself, he says "Achayat heshivoy," and the tailor responded, "Don't ask me how many stitches I stitched today. How many letters are in the Torah? That's your domain. Do you know your domain as much as you expect me to know my domain?" And he was very upset because of the first question he wasn't able to answer. Now, first of all, that just says something about either the caliber of questions or the caliber of the person answering. And he was very upset about this. So what happens? V'nistayer kamiyamin v'lo yachol l'chavein haminyan ad shishbiya b'shem v'amalach v'gilaloi. What happens was is that he recited the name of Hashem in some way, and an angel came to him and revealed him the number of letters. V'somach liboy al ha'davar Zani was extremely happy, and in fact he writes them down. So just in case you're wondering, he has a whole list. I'm just giving you examples. So for instance, the letter Aleph, V'nini chozer la'amidam lefanach b'kitzunim, writes, the letter Aleph appears, Shnaim v'arboim elef v'shlosh me'os v'shim v'shira, right? And he goes through each letter in the Torah, and he tells you how many times it appears. Now, the reason why the story is fascinating is, first of all, you see a number of interesting things. Number one is that he obviously knew a lot of answers to a lot of questions, number one. Number two is that he really cared about it. It wasn't that the questions were just simply his resume or his portfolio. This, he really actually cared about the material that he was being asked, and to a degree, and also you see the specificity. I mean, to say, everything in his mind, as Dr. Abramson said, everything in his mind was in systems. Everything fitted into a place. There was no random information which was fitting into a miscellaneous file. You know, we have in our filing systems, you have all the files and then we have the miscellaneous file. There was no miscellaneous in his type of thinking. And this is the type of thinking that we see coming out from Rav Saadia Gaon. So let's turn to his parsha note itself. As we do with Ramban, first thing you want to know about a book is, where do you go? Read the introduction. It's the instruction manual. He's telling you what he wants to do with it. It happens to be Saadia Gaon had two Pirushim on the Torah. One is called the Pirush HaKatzar, the short explanation, and one is the Pirush HaAroch, the longer explanation. Unfortunately, we don't have much of his Pirush HaAroch. It's not extant in its full. We do have much of the Pirush HaKatzar, the shorter explanation. They differ slightly. The audience of the Pirush HaKatzar was actually the Hamon Am, not even Jewish people. It was really a basic understanding of the Bible. And part of the reason why that was important was it was important, he felt, for the masses, as Dr. Abramson said, to have access to the real meaning. And he, in his mind, there was no gray area. It was black and white. He wanted people to understand exactly what the Torah meant, and he therefore translated it, as you'll see in a few examples. So here's what he says when it comes to his introduction to his explanation, and it really gives us a very fascinating insight into him. Now, it's interesting, as opposed to Ramban, the focus of his Pirush is not going to be overlaid on Rashi. Why is that? Yeah, because Rashi is not born yet. Rashi is certainly not the centerpiece of his Pirush, but he does say the following. This is really something which is emblematic. The more you read of Rav Saadia Gaon, the more it corroborates itself. Everything is completely self-substantiating. Everything is completely in state. And so this idea affects his philosophy and his linguistics and his polemics. Here we go. So da'atama ayin ba'torah b'sefer ha'torah azeh. So you reader who are about to engage in reading this Torah, because I'm just helping you read it. You're not reading me, you're reading it. So I'm helping you gain access to it. Ki avopi she'archo yakor ma'od, umadjegason nasa'o ad shelo yedame elov, shar sifri anavua. Listen, it is on its own plane. This book, the Sefer Torah, is not similar to any other books, even prophetic books. Even though its language will explain very, very impenetrable ideas, there must be another system which is above and beyond the system of the Torah, which helps us understand the Torah. Meaning, don't read this book as if this is the be-all and end-all. There must be another system or systems which we can use in congruence with the written Torah itself in order to understand what God really wants. Okay, he says there's another two systems that we need to consider when reading this book and understanding how it affects our lives. System one, this is so fascinating. This is really a remarkable point. It speaks to who he is. Harishon, system number one is, who kodem la Torah, it precedes the Torah, v'hu mofes ha-seichel asher bo yada ha-adam. It is logic. Fascinating. He says the Torah operates within the system of logic. And in fact, if you go to the end of his paragraph, I apologize, we didn't go down here. If you go to the end of this section over here, he says, We have to believe that God is righteous. Hashem would never have placed a system of Torah into our logical realm that doesn't work with our logical realm. He would never give us something which is illogical, which doesn't work with any. He gives two examples. Kamoit tzedek v'yosher. Tzedek is like righteousness, and yosher, straight honesty. And let's hold the questions for just a second, okay? Just to get a little bit of inertia over here. He says that we have to understand, we have to read the Torah in the system of logic. Now, this is an unbelievable point. An unbelievable point, he says, but it's tempered by a second system. And the second system is Hashnia Mofes Hasheni. The second system over here is Mu'char Lemofes HaTorah, is after the Torah was given. V'hu Yediyah Kabbalah Sanviim Ha'eich Haru Al Kol Davar Chadash. He says it is how the rabbis had the tradition of how the system works. So he and he goes on to say, how to perform those commandments. The logic won't help us get there. These traditions of how to do it are not written in the Torah. So he gives examples. Lemashal, kama pamim yismalel adam echol yom. The Torah tells us to pray. But how many times do we pray? So logic's not going to help you over there. So how do we know that? Meaning the Torah is telling us to do something, it's not giving us instructions of how to do it. Why? Because that part wasn't written down. That part was transmitted via tradition. So obviously there must be a tradition. Interestingly enough, footnote over here, when you read the introduction to Siddur, he tells you how you know that. He actually records that in the Torah it talks about 18 people praying. And he says, of course, that's the format of the 18 brachas. Right? Fascinating. There's one of his five reasons, because he has five paragraphs of reasons why there's 18 brachas in Rosh, and that's one of them. Okay? So just as an example. And he says, what does it mean? You give charity. So what type of charity? How much? From what? In cash? Whether it be in labor, in time, in energy? How does that work? What malacha is it not to do on Shabbos? You can't transgress Shabbos or it's a capital punishment. But what's malacha? So his point is that you have a system which precedes and a system which follows, and these two systems are the guiding themes of all our understanding all Torah. And of course, over here, embedded over here, is of course his response to the Karaites. You only have one system, and that is logic and Torah. You don't have the other system, which is tradition. And that's you see over here is something which the ability to balance that Greek philosophy, the logic, pure reason, at the same time as tradition, and that's where he stands. Let's take a very quick example of what his Pirush HaKatzar looks like. Here's an example of what the Pirush HaKatzar will look like. It's a very short paragraph just to be found on the bottom of page 2. On the screens over here, he will essentially quote a pasuk, and he will give a little explanation of it. So let's take an example. This is after the Bris Ben Abasarim, the covenant that Hashem has with Abraham in Bereshis Perek Yud Zayin. This is Vayachal Ledaber Itoy Vayal Elokim El Avraham. God finishes speaking to Abraham and he ascends. So now here is Rav Saadia Gaon. Vakasher Kila Medaber Itoy Hisromeim Or Elokim Me El Avraham. As God finishes speaking, the light of God ascends. What is Saadia Gaon added to the pasuk over here? What has he helped us with? What is he trying to transmit to us extra? In his explanation, very very terse. Very simple.
Interaction.
Well, so what he said over here is? But what specific word over here is the additional word that he is adding to this pasuk? And that is?
Or.
Light. Why is he saying that the light of God ascended to heaven? Couldn't we understand that God, in whichever vehicle God decided to ascend to heaven, God ascended to heaven? Why is he adding in the word or? Because what he's doing is he is now, based on tradition, we know that God, this is what's called an anthropomorphism, where God is being described as doing a human action to ascend. So he is moving away from that ascent, like Unculus will do in a week's time. He is moving away from anthropomorphism in this particular case. So he is inserting tradition into his explanation of the Tanakh. That's an example of one of the systems, the Mofes Hasheni, which he talked about over here. And he's making it very clear. Remember, in Rav Saadia Gaon's terms, everything is black or white. Everything is very clear. There's no gray area, and there's no anthropomorphism. anthropomorphism, if it's the Or Elohim, the light of God, or the cloud of God, or whatever else God is represented in. There we go. So that is an example of the Pirush HaKatzar. One specific idea. Let's go into polemics over here, because as Dr. Abramson said, he was a fierce arguer on the side of traditional Judaism, and that expressed itself in many of his explanations. So here's an example of his Pirush HaAroch. Famous pasuk tells us in the Torah, one of these, you know, which is still practiced in the culture of Islam, more literally, is ayin tachas ayin, shayin tachas shayin, yad tachas yad. So the Torah tells us that should you remove somebody else's hand, then what happens is, you have a very simple quid pro quo, and you have your hand removed at the same time. And if you remove their eye, their eye is removed. Now, interestingly enough, is this in practice in Judaism, traditional Judaism from time immemorial? Is this something we practiced? Never, right? This is the Gemara tells us. The Gemara actually tells us that this means money, the monetary loss that a person experiences by losing a body limb through your interaction is what you pay them back. Okay, as the Gemara tells us. So in his Pirush over here, this is a quotation of Rav Saadia Gaon. He says the following. Let's take a quick look at over here. He says the following. Lo nuchal lefaresh ezeh pasuk kamashma'oi. He says, look, this just doesn't work. It can't be that you're removing the person's eye. Now, why? If you had to finish the sentence, why? What would you say? Why it isn't? Because why? Why is that we do not practice this?
Well, for one thing, it's not practiced.
Okay, so once again, so the reason that the Gemara gives through a log, in the Gemara Baba Kama has a whole laundry list of reasons. What he does not do is he does not quote that Gemara Baba Kama. What does he go to? He goes to logic. Okay, coming back to his introduction, he says the following. As was mentioned, ki im adam hika ayin chaver v'sara shlishis or enov. Let's say you partially blinded another individual. Right, so don't do this at home without close supervision. He says, "Eich yitochin shiyichaveh makeh kazois belito service umigras." So how are you going to get the exact precision? You know, how are you going to blind them to a third of their vision to give it back to them? Eich yitochin, he says, "Ulay yachshich or enov kuloi." What happens if you excessively blind the person? Right, v'yoter kosheh hakviya v'apetz v'achubara. What happens if you talk about burns or beatings, you know? So how exactly do you approximate that kind of thing? He just says it's an impractical measure to be able to impose. So what's he using to prove that this cannot be logical? This cannot be as its pshat would indicate? Logic, right? So he's not going to tradition because the people he's interacting with don't believe in that second system, so he has to deal with logic. Let's take it, he goes further, and then he says the following. He says, Amali ben Zuta Hatzidoki. And he now records a conversation he has with an individual called Ben Zutta. Ben Zutta was a Sadducee, which Sadducee in the times of the Gemara were the people who adhered only to the written text. And in his generation, as Dr. Abramson mentioned, they were the Karaites. And he says, V'aloi kosu b'makom acher kasher yiten mumba adam ken yinot sen boy. So the Sadducee said, well, there's another pasuk said that, which it seems to indicate, if you inflict a wound on another person, you will get it back. Sounds like the Torah itself is very much for might is right. Let's apply that. And the Rav Saadia Gaon responded, "Ki yesh on a base tachas al," a very, very specific linguistic note that he says, "Keni nasan elav oinesh." When Ben Zita atzidoki heishiv, another Sadducee, Ben Zita, respond to him. Ben Zita, the same one, kasher also keni aseloi. I mean, he goes on for a linguistic argument, and finally he closes it up by saying, "Vagone shevine shimshon amar kasher asuli ken es elohem." Later on in Tanakh, you believe in Tanakh, right? Yes, you agree with that? Absolutely, because you're a Karaite. So now, later on in Tanakh, Shimshon was wronged. People did terrible things to him, right? When he married his first wife, and not, this is before Delilah. He married his first Philistine wife, and they tricked him, and they did terrible things. They took away his wife, and then they killed her family. A whole bunch of terrible things. And he says, "I'm going to do to them as they did to me." He didn't take away their wives. He didn't burn down their houses. What it means to say is, "I'm going to exact justice from them." And then the conversation goes on, and the Sadducee says, "Well, the Karaite says, well, you know, is it worse to be a poor person? And what happens if the person is poor and you're trying to exact money and you can't get money out of the person?" And Rav Saadia Gaon says, "Well, poverty is something which changes; blindness doesn't." And the whole, what's fascinating about this entire discussion, which is between Rav Saadia Gaon and this particular Karaite, is it's always in the confines of logic, not tradition. Because again, the conversation he's having is with a person who disregards tradition. So therefore you'll see times in his pirush where it'll be more inducing the tradition or more inducing logic depending on who he's recording. He has a specific case of in his writings of this Ben Zutta individual, okay, which is it has risen to a degree where he felt that he needed to reach out. In terms of polemics, that's one specific example which the Karaites have. In terms of halacha, one of the biggest jobs that a Gaon had, a person of his stature, was to answer all the letters of all the questions of all the people in his under his jurisdiction. And you have to remember, there were not, as Dr. Abramson said, there were not a lot of yeshivas. There was Surup and Bedis and Arda. There was the main areas, and all letters, all questions would be essentially funneled through these yeshivas. So although his job, he did lots of things, a lot of it was tending for the flocks abroad. And here's an example of one of his books, which he has. This is the top is actually, if I'm not mistaken, in Arabic, and the translation is Sifrei Rabbeinu Saadia Gaon Ben Yosef HaPiyumi, and it is with an additions of Naftali Yosef Dierensberg, who is now publishing this. So this is an example of some of his responses. So let's just take one example of a response that he has. This gives you a sense of the what's going on in culture today. He has a fascinating question he was asked. This is a short one. He says, Shaltim, you asked me, Bar Yisrael de Yahav Barivsa Lagoy Shari Oy Asar, a Jew who is giving to a non-Jew, can they loan to a non-Jew with interest or not? Is it mutar or asur? Is it permitted or prohibited? Is rishus de leshamute or no? Do you have the permission to excommunicate such a Jew? Meaning, not only is it good or bad, but is the question's leaning towards it's really bad. Is it bad enough to excommunicate such a Jew? This question is fascinating on numerous levels. First of all, what language is it asked in?
Aramaic,
because he's living in Babylon at this point in time. Okay, so this is why it is very important to this is the lingua franca right over here. But more than that, I apologize. There's Arabic, but it is asked in it is asked, which I would assume is still in some form of usage at this point in time of Aramaic. Number two is an interesting thing is that it tells you a bit of an interesting relationship of the Jews and the non-Jews. This question is already leaning in the direction of assuming. Not good, right? Do you have the permission to excommunicate such a Jew? This would never be a question asked in England at this point in time. Okay? Actually, in fact, at this point in time, I'm trying to remember when the Jews arrived in England. I don't think the Jews were in England, but let's say a century or two later when the Jews were allowed into England, the only way the Jews were able to survive was as moneylenders. That was the only trade that they were allowed, and because of the only trade they were allowed, therefore they were all slandered as these terrible money launderers and these wealthy people who are gaining on behalf of society. Under Islam, it's a very completely different picture at this point in time, which is a fascinating point to ponder. So here's his answer. He says the following. He says, "Hechin chazina deribis degoy kilo." Hechin chazina. This is what I would suggest. Said Saadia Gaon. One second. Yes, okay, I'm just getting it in the actual text in front of me. It's a little easier to see this one. Here we go. He says, "Deribis degoy killer veleka leshamute derachmona loy aser boy raisa lemiton beribis legoy." Look, the Torah didn't explicitly outlaw it, so you can't put a person in excommunication status for that. It says, use interest against your brother. And there is an ability you can, if need be, to take usury, to take interest from a non-Jewish loan. By the way, this is not seen in terms of where you put the default. Does that mean to say that we're allowed to take advantage of other people, or we're allowed, or in the Jewish system they've got a ticket out? I mean, you say, what's the default? Default loans are that loans have interest. That's how you earn money. Money and time are worth money, are worth something. So the Jews are given a dispensation out. This is not seen l'nachrit hashich. Doesn't mean to say that you should go take advantage of non-Jews. It means to say that the normal system of the world is in place when in relationship to a non-Jewish loan. He says, and he goes on to quote a Gemara, and he says, "Miu man de medakdek b'mile loy loizif." A person who's careful about their matters should not loan to a non-Jew with interest. That's what he suggests. He goes on to say, based on the Gemara, which he quotes in Baba Metzia, that the Gemara concludes by saying, "V'tani Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai Omer, kol sheyesh loy ma'os umalvi osan b'loy beribis, shloy beribis, olav akosuv Omer kaspoy lo nosan b'neshech." Apostle Tehillim describing a very special or pious individual is a person who never uses interest, and he goes on to say, "Pirshu chachamim kaspol enasam beneshek tafila beribis legoy lo yohav." He says, "Not even giving usury to a goy, to a non-Jewish person." This is very fascinating because this is indicative, first of all, of the types of questions he gets: contract questions, death and inheritance questions. This is embedded among them, and the question he's answering over here is also indicative of the type of times that he's dealing with as well. Very fascinating, an aspect of Rav Saadia Gaon which is not usually actually focused on at this point in time. If we go further, let's take an interesting look over here. Happens to be that Saadia Gaon is one of the earlier people who actually produces a text of the Siddur that we have today. So this is one of the earlier origins of a Siddur, although we know that the prayer service, the structure has been there, but actually to have a book itself, we don't see that until really these times, the late part of the first millennium. And here's an example of what his introduction to it is. So let's just take a quick look at what he's talking about over here. And you'll notice on the right hand side, it is written in.
Well, that's Arabic.
That's Arabic. Hebrew. Arabic in Hebrew script, because that's what the populace are reading right now. And the translation is on the left, meaning to say the original was on the right, and the translation is on the left. That's the Hebrew. So those of us in the room who are proficient in Arabic, or feel free to try the right side and tell me if I'm mistranslating. But in the meantime, here is the reason why he decided that it's important to write a siddur. It's a very lengthy introduction. This is a more practical part, and he says the following. Pasach michi berav v'amar yisparach yishtabach Hashem Elokim Elokei Yisrael l'malem mikol tiur. Hashem is above all description. Mikevan shenusach tefilos b'nei Yisrael birkoseya na Hashem yisparach eino kosov b'mikra. Since we cannot find in our actual scripts the prayer service itself and the actual words we say on a daily basis thrice, he says, therefore, as many aspects of the Torah not written in it, coming back to the notion that the Torah is tradition and written, right? This is an example of tradition. Okay? Therefore, it is necessary to have, this is part of the tradition. And the tefillos that we do find in the Torah are so entrenched in the particular situation that we can't really extract them just wholesale and use them. Skipping two lines, uvishtehen, and in both of these things, kolomar betzvila uvebrachos. When it comes to both tefillah and the blessings, we say samchu al ma shekiblu haanashim b'mesorah minivyei Hashem. V'arayim shnei sedarim. There were two sets of traditions about tefillah. What were they? Echad lizman hamlucha, ve'echad lizman hagalus. There were two traditions of prayer, one during the time that we lived as a sovereign nation in the land of Israel, one in the times of Galus. He gives an example, actually, earlier on in his introduction, where he says, for instance, with a bracha which we say, Tekab shofar gadol, lecher usenu, what we call kibbutz galios, that everybody should be brought back to the land of Israel, he indicates that that was only a tefillah which was said, of course, in exile, but it was in fact the prayer which supplanted that at the times of sovereignty was, let us succeed at our wars. Fascinating, right? Two sets of tefillos he indicates. Therefore, it's important to bring these all together, to congregate them. And to write them down. Why is it so necessary now? Why out of all centuries do I need to do it now? Three things are happening as I watch it, says Rav Saadia Gaon. Haznacha, abandoning the prayer. Vahosafa, additions to the prayer. Vahashmata, and leaving out sections of prayer. V'yesh biglalam l'chashosh l'shichcha v'l'kfiyas hashinui. And I'm concerned that there's going to be abrogation of the tefillah, so I'm going to now create the canon of what it's going to look like based on the original tradition. And he goes on to talk about when he moved around and the hashmatot and the omissions which he was seeing in society at this point in time, which therefore catalyzed his need to write the Siddur. And today we can thank Art Scroll, Ken and Koren, and all the other printing companies who are doing such a great job with the Siddurim can thank 1,200 years ago, essentially, Rav Saadia Gaon, for starting the process of canonizing the Siddur as we have it. Another very important aspect of his work. Coming to a... I didn't have a chance to get to his dictionary, the 90 words. One example of one of those 90 words, just as an example, is he says the word pre-Eitz Hadar. Remember, the Torah tells us that on Sukkos, one of the things that the commandment is to shake or to lift on Sukkos is pre-Eitz Hadar, this beautiful fruit. Now, how are we supposed to know what that is? You know, you go to the supermarket and you ask for pre-Eitz Hadar, what are they going to give you? So he notes that the word Hadar, if you in Arabic, actually means a citron. Okay, so he says, how do we understand it? Is we go to the Arabic, which is a beautiful example of the logic system also superimposing itself on the Torah system, as he mentions in the introduction. This is an example of how he uses the culture around him to have access to the Torah itself. One last idea, and this is in philosophy. Of course, his magnum opus is Emunot Vedayot, his book which talks about belief and opinions, which is an exceptionally dense and hard to access book. But here's one example of something which has transformed the way we look at philosophy and is in fact still our belief system today. He asked, this is a question actually starts many, many centuries before him, and it's Apostle Ken Yechezkel, which is in the 33rd parak. It says the following, Hatsofeh, let's say you have a small village and you have one person who's in charge of watching the village for attackers at night. Ki yireh sar cherev ba'a, and he notices that there is a band of thieves approaching the city. V'loy toka b'shofar, and nobody blew, and he didn't sound the alarm. He didn't press the button, he didn't blow the horn. V'am lo nizar, the people weren't aware of the approaching enemy. V'tovoy ha'chere v'tikach mehem nefesh, and there was a fatality owing to his not performing his duties. Hu ba'avonon yelkach, he will be killed in his sin. V'damo miyad ha'tzofeh edrosh, the person who was killed deserved to die, but I will demand recompense from that watchman who did not do his job. Now that is what we call is a dialectic which has been at the heart of many, many philosophical discussions. Here you have a person who's killed because the watchman never sounded the alarm. So did the watchman kill him? What would have happened if the watchman had sounded the alarm? Would that person have died otherwise? Was that person deserving of death? What or how do you look at God's plan and your involvement in it? What happens if he'd woken up, he'd had a coffee that night, and he blew the horn, and then the person was, had been saved? So would the person have died otherwise? That's the question which has been plaguing us for centuries. Here's the simple explanation. Rav Saadia Gaon says in Emunat Vedeos himself, in the fourth Ma'amar, in the fifth paragraph, he says the following. V'shalim, people ask me, im hoysa mesiras ha'adam la'ariga acher am echad mimase abore. So let's say a particular individual has a spiritual X on their head. Rachman al-Litzlan, they've done something which has now crossed a red line. So in God's books, that person is walking dead. Or they deserve some sort of form of challenge from God. So what happens when you have a particularly evil individual comes along and does the job for God, right? They perform a mahadran operation of God in this particular thing, like Jezebel, and she kills all these prophets. So, so who do we attribute it to? We say, look, in the end of the day, the person must have deserved death because they died. But in the end of the day, she pulled the trigger. Right? So what do you do? Where do you lay blame? And this is these are the words of Rav Saadia Gaon, which essentially have become entrenched in our philosophical underpinnings, which are disputed by some commentaries like the Or HaChaim later on. But this is really mainstream Jewish tradition. That is, Anu Omrim. We say, says Saadia Gaon, Ki amaves maase Hashem, death is God's department, va'retzach maase haresha, but murder is human's department. That's a fascinating dialectic. Death is God's department, and murder is the human department. V'im kfar chivach chochma misa, ilu lo hizid harotzeach hazeh v'hargoy, hoya meis misiba acheres. He would have died somehow in another way if it weren't for this person letting them in. But you don't want to be that tool. The point is, and this is the famous philosophical debate, and the way that he passes it out is, God has got a plan for everybody he needs to take. You need to make very sure that you're not going to be the vehicle of that. Because if you choose to, you're culpable for making the choice to murder, even though the death was not in your hands. Which means to say, essentially, if you take the crime scene and you split it into two, and you see the person pulling the trigger is what the person is responsible for, not the death. That's what Rav Saadia Gaon is essentially saying over here. And he talks about it in more specific terms, let's say about thievery or loss. And this and the reflection of this on a responsible daily basis is that when something happens to us, I was driving down the road a few days ago and a stone hit my windshield and a small crack which every day grows bigger. So I can get up there, I can curse and think about that terrible person who on the other side of the street was driving too fast and must have shot up that rock at me, or I can say no. What he did, in this case had nothing to do with me, was his business, but what happened to me is God's business. And passing out reality, therefore, actually now separates other individuals from their harm they caused you, and rather it's your relationship with Hashem, which is a completely different way of looking at life. This is an example of what Rav Saadia Gaon does in his philosophy. So what we did is just to get a brief mapping out of what we did, we followed Rav Saadia Gaon through some thoughts in his introduction to Parshanot, the two systems he adds to understanding Torah. We looked at it as it expresses itself in polemics as he relates to the Karaites in the specific instance of Ayin Tachas Ayin. We talked about a halacha, and we saw an interesting historical aspect of his life as he responded, his contribution of the Siddur as we have it to today, and finally his philosophy and one very specific example of how that affects our day-to-day life today and mainstream Jewish tradition. I hope this has been something which helps us gain at least a little bit of a foothold in the life of somebody who changed our tradition. Thank you very much.
That was great, Rabbi. I really enjoyed it. I learned a lot. I forgot to mention one story, just to sort of humanize this superhuman individual. You'll recall that he was fired by the president of the academy, right? The exilarch, David Ben Zakkai. It happened that many years later, you know, after he was fired, he spent 20 odd years with unemployed. David Ben Zakkai passed away and left behind a young orphan child, and Rav Saadia Gaon took the child into his own home as his adopted son. Wow. And so even though he could have had tremendous bitterness against David Ben Zakkai, he nevertheless showed tremendous kindness to his son, who grew up being very devoted to Saadia Gaon.
That's beautiful, and that really is sort of